السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومواله. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome from Dar Sunna Latifia, New York, Hafizah Madrasa. We are here reading the book Quranic Facts Proven by Modern Science, and this is the first edition. Inshallah, we're going to go over these miracles in the Quran, which Quran actually predicted what science would prove much later on. They predicted what is happening in the universe now, and it's necessary to understand that the Quran was revealed in about 600 AD, Anjidimini, but from 600 to about 630, in that time span, that's when the Quran was revealed. And much later in modern science, now in the 1900s, as early as maybe even the 1600s, all the way to today, there's been constant modern discoveries that's constantly been proving the Quran as fact. And that's how we know that the word of Quran is the word of Allah. And so we open the book and we see on page number 3, the Quran challenges. Okay, so it starts off with a Quranic verse, and this is a challenge to the disbelievers who, at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and even after, until today, it was a challenge to them to produce something like the Quran. وَإِن كُنتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِّمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُم مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. And if ye are in doubt as to what we have revealed from time to time to our servant. So this first portion, I'm going to break it up portion by portion. So if you doubt what we've revealed from time to time to our servant, they're referring to the revelation of the Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you doubt that, then Allah continues with, then produce a surah like thereunto. So produce whatever we have produced, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you doubt that it's actually from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You think it's just the words of a man. In this case, a man who was considered to be illiterate. He didn't learn how to read and write. He was considered to be uneducated. So then produce a surah like him, like the surahs he is presenting to you. And call yourself, call your witnesses or helpers, if there are any, besides Allah, if your doubts are true. So, you know, if once you doubt and you're able to create a surah like that, or if you need help, you know, you call your helpers, and once you do this, call your witnesses. Unfortunately, they were unable to create surahs like that of the Quran. This verse was in... and then it continues on in... فَإِن لَّمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. But if ye cannot, and of a surety you cannot. So, you know, and if you can't produce a surah, and if you can't bring someone to witness that you've produced a surah like the Quran, like what was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they're so sure, the Quran is saying, and we're sure you can't, and of a surety you cannot, then fear the fire whose fuel is men and stones, which is prepared for those who reject the faith. So then, even then, if you continue to reject the faith, then prepare yourself. You were given the opportunity, you were given the challenge, you now see that you're unable to do something that you claim that an illiterate man is doing on his own. He's producing such poetic verses. Then, you know, you're going to end up in hellfire. And hellfire is made for those who reject the faith. And this is in the Quran, Quranic verse, once again, in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 23 and 24. So, alhamdulillah, we started off with the challenges the Quran presents. And we know one thing now. Over the course of the rest of this book, we're going to go over verses that were not possible to have been known at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we know that no one else would be able to produce surahs and verses like that, as if they tried, they would never be able to predict the same things that the Quran predicted, because they don't have the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had. And we're going to start off with the first topic, the first category of the miracles of the Quran, in which the Quran the organic facts proven by modern science. And much of this is proven very recently. We're going to start off with the creation of the universe, the Big Bang. Now, the Big Bang, it's deemed to be a theory, but it's almost generally accepted in today's world, and it's almost undeniable because there's even proof of the existence of the Big Bang. The Big Bang is, as everyone knows, it's the idea that the universe was one small, hot, dense blob, kind of, and all of a sudden, something happened. It started moving apart really, really fast. And this happened about 13.8 billion years ago, close to 14 billion years ago, and that's the idea of when the universe actually started. That's what scientists believe. And there's evidence of this, this actually happening. I'll go over that as we continue. So this, the creation of the universe, the Big Bang, is also connected to another aspect of the topic of astronomy, as we're going to later also go on with the expanding of the universe. It's essentially the same topic. They go really hand in hand. I just wanted to let you guys know, it's going to seem like I'm going to get repetitive when I get there, but it's the same topic. So the creation of the Big Bang, I'll start off with reading the verse.
أَوَلَمْ يَرَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ
Do not the unbelievers see that the heavens and the earth were joined together as one unit of creation before we clothed them asunder? This is just meaning that the heavens and the earth, everything in all of creation, we know how big the whole universe was, all together as one. And it's saying that the heavens and the earth were even together, and they were together until we clothed them asunder, until we split them apart, we sent them their separate ways. And that's the whole idea behind the Big Bang. Now, the Big Bang was an idea that was only formulated extremely recently. It was taken the idea of multiple scientists, Edwin Hubble, his many decades of scientific work, and even they used the ideas of Einstein. And the Big Bang theory, it's one of the famous aspects of it, was it came after the death of Albert Einstein, but it argued with his idea of what a universe was, and he is deemed to be one of the smartest men in history, and so it combated it. Yeah, it continued to be something that is almost undeniable today. So the next verse is
ثم استوى إلى السماء وهي دخان فقال لها وللأرض ائتيا طوعا أو كرها قالتا أتينا طائعين.
Moreover, he comprehended in his design the sky, and it had been as smoke. He said to it and the earth, come ye together, willingly or unwillingly. They said, we do come together in willing obedience. This is, you know, the creation of when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. And he says over here, he commanded it to come together. And that's when he brought it together. And then after that, we see, actually the verse before, it shows that he split it apart. He sent them in separate ways. So there is actually proof of the Big Bang theory occurring. We know today that there was energy, since all that energy and all the universe and everything is stored in such hot and dense, such a small space. It must be so hot, so dense, containing much, much energy, a lot of energy. And so for it to spread apart, the energy has to still have some kind of existence in the air somewhere. And this was later proven to be true as it was taken in by radio signals. But before that, the existence of this idea came up, the Big Bang came up in 1927 by this Belgian theoretical physicist. His name was George Leitmeier, and he came up with the idea of an expanding universe as well as the Big Bang theory when he took the ideas of Edwin Hubble earlier in 1925, where Edwin Hubble, he discovered it. He would just observe different stars, and he realized that they started just moving away farther and farther from the Earth. And the farther they were, the faster they were moving away from the Earth. And this is the whole idea of the Big Bang. And it was until a couple years later that, at this time, astronomers, they came up with the idea that there must be some energy laying around, because that is so much energy to have been in such a small space. So what they did was they got a radio and they just heard a hissing sound. two people. They had a huge radio. It was called like a horn, and it was just a hissing sound. They thought, you know, it's a sound like when something's not plugged in correctly. So they were checking everything was correct. They even cleared the pigeon poop that they saw in the horn, because it's a big horn. It was outside. It was a couple meters wide. And they cleaned it, and they realized that that was always there. And they checked the frequency, and it matched the frequency of the energy that was proposed, like that astronomers, they predicted that that's the energy that's still going to exist billions of years after the Big Bang. And also the idea that, you know, the stars were moving farther and farther away. The idea of George Leitmeyer was that, so if we work back in time, they were moving closer and closer to us, and we were all one body at one point. But now, as it is, the universe is rapidly expanding. There's many more points. I'm going to go over that later when we actually go to the point of how the universe is actually expanding. Next, I'd like to go over the light of the reflected moon. The light of the moon is reflected light. The light of reflected moon. The light of the moon is reflected light. We're going to start off with the Quranic verse. تبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سراجا وقمرا منيرا. Blessed is he who made constellations in the skies and placed therein a lamp and a moon giving light. This is in Surah Al-Fur'an, verse number 61. I'm also going to read the next couple of verses all together. هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء والقمر نورا وقدره منازل لتعلموا عدد السنين والحساب ما خلق الله ذلك إلا بالحق يفصل الآيات لقوم يعلمون. It is he who made the sun to be a shining glory and the moon to be a light of beauty. This is in the also Quranic verse, Surah Yunus, verse number 10, Surah number 10, verse number 5.
Alam taraw kayfa khalaqa Allahu sab'a samawatin tibaqa wa ja'ala al-qamara feehinna nuran wa ja'ala ash-shamsa siraja.
See ye not how Allah has created the seven heavens one above the other, and made the moon a light and in their midst, and made the sun as a glorious lamp. This is in the Quran, Surah number 71, verses 15 through 16. So I like to focus on the second one. The translation, I'll read that again. It is he who made the sun to be a shining glory and the moon to be a light of beauty. I'd like to read another translation as well. This translation, it gives a proper translation, but it doesn't do it justice. Another translation is, it is he who made the sun a shining light and the moon a derived light. The derived light comes from the word nuron, and determined for it phases, that you may know the number of years and the counts in time. Allah has not created this except in the truth. He details the signs for our people who know. That is the whole verse. So the use of the word Nuron in Arabic, it's known as light, brought from somewhere. It's known as derived light. And so that means that the light from the moon isn't its own light. It came from somewhere. And this is how we know that earlier in the verse, it mentions how the sun is a shining light. It's its own light. But then the moon is just derived light. It's possible that they mentioned it together to have the correlation between them. But the idea is they knew that the moon's light wasn't its own light, and it was reflected from the sun. And the idea of this actually was thought of, it was speculated before by Greek philosophers, Anaxagoras in 500 BCE. He had the idea that maybe because different phases give us different light, it might be reflected from somewhere. But since it was back then, they did not have the equipment or anything possible. And as we said, you know, the Quranic facts were proven by modern science. So while that was an idea, it wasn't proven until 1962, where a group of researchers from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, they banded together and they used a laser, and they figured out that the moon was actually the reflected light. That was when it was first and finally proven that the light of the moon was reflected light.
And that equipment, that millisecond pulse laser, was only available especially recently. And this is quite interesting because that happened in 1962, and altogether, a couple years later, they went to the moon. A lot was happening in that short span of time, but this was over 1,000 years after the Uran was able to predict it. Now we're going to move on to the rotation of the sun.
وهو الذي خلق الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر كل في فلك يسبحون.
It is he who created the night and the day, and the sun and the moon. All celestial bodies swim along, each in its rounded course.
And then the next verse says, لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون.
It is not permitted to the sun to catch up to the moon, nor can the night outstrip the day. Each swims along in its own orbit, according to law. This is in the Quran, chapter number 36, verse number 40. So these verses, it talks about these celestial bodies, all celestial bodies, they swim along around in its rounded course. Not only the sun. I mentioned here the sun rotates. The sun, as we know, the earth, as the earth is a celestial body, it rounds in orbits around the sun. But the sun and everything else in nearly every other galaxy, they're all revolving around something. Everything that has a mass, it would require, we know in physics, we know that the force of gravity is pulling it, and then it's just orbiting around, sometimes not even completely circle, maybe even an elliptical orbit, but it's definitely, because there's a larger mass, it has a force of attraction, and it's pulling it, it's allowing it to accelerate towards the center, and that's how the Earth is revolving around the Sun, and that's how the Sun is revolving around even the center of the galaxy. It has its own orbit, and it continues to orbit around the center of the Milky Way. And it's moving around the center of the Milky Way very fast. Some figures even say it's almost as, I believe, 80,000 kilometers per second. There are some other figures, but since the Milky Way is huge, everything else in the Milky Way is also revolving around something. And that's what this verse is saying. All celestial bodies swim along, each in its rounded course. The rounded course is referring to the orbit. So we're going to move on to how the sun will extinguish after a certain period.
وَالشَّمْسُ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرٍ لَهَا ذَلِكَ تَقْدِيرُ الْعَزِيزِ الْعَلِيمِ.
And the sun runs its course for a period determined for it. That is the decree of him, the exalted in might, the all-knowing. This is in the Quran, chapter number 36, verse number 38. It says here, it gives us a short explanation. The light of the sun is due to a chemical process on its surface that has been taking place continuously for the past 5 billion years. It will come to an end at some point of time in the future when the sun will be totally extinguished, leading to extinction of all life on Earth. So, we know that the life of the sun has, due to radiation calculations, the use of chemistry and physics, in today's world, we're able to figure out that the sun has lived for about 4.6 billion years, and obviously the Earth shorter than that. But now we also know that the sun will eventually die out. Now, for much of history, people treated the sun as gods, and even as I mentioned before, the people of Greece in Anaxagoras' time, they even arrested Anaxagoras because of their acts of against the sun, because they treated the sun as a god. But obviously, we know that now that the sun is going to die, there's no way it can be treated as a god. Even though people used to imprison other people for not believing that the sun was a god. So now we know that the sun will extinguish sometime. Scientists predicted it's going to be, well, it's accurate. It's, they use mathematical calculations, and they found out that the sun will die out in 5 billion years. So we're at the half of its lifespan. It's lived for about 5 billion years. It's going to live for another 5 billion years. It has a lifespan of about 10 billion years. And it runs on hydrogen. It burns it, and it has a supply. And it's going to burn out because it's emitting light. It's emitting energy. it's emitting something. So eventually, once it runs out of its fuel, it's going to die out. And this was figured out. The life of the Earth was actually figured out much recently as well. As in, this was, it was said that, you know, Allah gave the sun a time limit. It knows when the sun's going to, it says over here, for a period determined for it. But in 1920s, before the 1920s, when Albert Einstein famously came up with the equation E equals mc squared, that is when humans were able to find out the life of the Earth. And that's how they knew. They were like, okay, this is how it's going to die eventually. And they used E equals mc squared because E equals mc squared is the equation to convert mass and energy. So to figure out how much mass something has, use the equation to change between the mass and the energy, where C would be the speed of light. And you would need this because you need to know how much energy the sun actually has and how much it is expending. And eventually, if you do the mathematical calculation, you can easily figure out how long the sun will have to live. It's not even something complicated as the others. It's just using a basic equation that you learn in high school, and you can figure out other figures you could find online. So that is how we know that the sun will extinguish after a certain period. And once again, you know, the Quran predicted this much before they found out the actual life of the sun in the 20th century. So the presence of interstellar matter. الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا. He who created the heavens and the earth and all that is between. And this is in the Quran, chapter 25, verse number 59. The explanation here, it gives a short explanation. Space outside organized astronomical systems was earlier assumed to be a vacuum. Astrophysicists later discovered the presence of bridges of matter in this interstellar space. These bridges of matter are called plasma and consist of completely ionized gas containing equal number of free electrons and positive ions. Plasma is sometimes called the fourth state of matter, besides the three known states, such as solid, liquid, and gas. So, what this is saying is that earlier and for much of history, I believe around up till the 1600s, it was thought that the space between the bridges between different planets and different celestial bodies was empty. There was nothing there. It was an empty space. But now science has discovered that, you know, that there's presence of bridges and there's actually plasma in that space. And so there's thought to be nothing there for much of time. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said He created everything, including what is in between. He isn't going to create nothing. And so since He said this, we know that there is something, there was something between the heavens and the earth. And this was the presence of interstellar matter brought up by the Quran. Next, we're going to go about the expanding universe. I spoke about this before, you know, the Big Bang Theory, where everything was together. And since everything was together, it's also one point that's very important to know, that scientists today know that the earth was once molten because of the Big Bang Theory. When everything's in one small spot, everything was on fire, everything was really hot, it was had a lot of energy. And so it was known that through studies, scientists figured out that the whole Earth was once molten. It took billions of years to cool down until it became habitable. And this was because, once again, because of the Big Bang, where everything was together at one point. But also, the expanding universe, I'm gonna read the verse here. والسماء بنيناها بأيد وإنا لموسعون. With the power and skill did we construct the firmament, for it is we who create the vastness of space. In 1925, an American astronomer by the name of Edwin Hubble, we mentioned him before in his works, where he would observe, very specifically, he observed three stars, and he realized that the farther they were from the Earth, the faster they were moving away from the Earth. And provided observational evidence that all galaxies are receding from one another. So they're moving away, which implies that the universe is expanding. The expansion of the universe is now an established fact. So it's undeniable that the universe is expanding, and the idea of the Big Bang, it was treated as a theory until the reception of those radio waves. But the idea that the universe is expanding at a quick rate is undeniable. And surprisingly, there's almost nothing that is faster than light. But one of the things that is actually faster than light is the expansion of the universe. And if you search it up, the expansion of the universe is occurring at about 68 kilometers per second per megaparsec. The megaparsec is a small sliver of a second. A megaparsec is, I believe, approximately like 4,400 4,400 megaparsecs is equal to 1 second. It's a figure like that. But if you convert it, you're going to eventually find that 68 kilometers per second per megaparsec is approximately 300,000 kilometers per second. And that's slightly faster than the speed of light. But it's showing you at the vast rate how quick the universe is expanding. And it's definitely that the universe is expanding, and that's a proven organic fact. And finally, we're going to go over the protection of the sky, the sky's protection. And we're going to read the verse.
وَجَعَلْنَا السَّمَاءَ سَقْفًا مَحْفُوظًا وَهُمْ عَنْ آيَاتِهَا مُعْرِضُونَ.
We made the sky a protective ceiling, and yet they are turning away from our signs. The Quran points to the sky's protection as a sign of Allah. The protective properties of the sky were discovered by scientific research conducted in the 20th century. So as this passage says, it was in the 1900s, the 20th century, where the humans were, scientists discovered that the earth was, sorry, the sky actually had protections. The sky's protection referring to the actual atmosphere, which protects us from a variety of things. The atmosphere gives us so many benefits, but I'm going to focus on the protective properties, because while it does have benefits, the idea here is that the sky is a protective ceiling. So primarily it protects us from two very major things, right? One of them is the ultraviolet rays from the sun. So now as we need the sun's light and the sun's heat to live. And it's a wonderful thing. But the sun has things that we do not want. There's many aspects of the sun that we don't generally appreciate, which is the UV rays, which are very harmful to every living thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created everything on earth just perfect for the humans. And so He even created this this atmosphere that was able to protect, and it would filter the ultraviolet light from the sun, those rays that would be harmful to humans and any other living thing. And the atmosphere, it filters it out, so we don't receive anything nearly as harmful. And also another aspect of the sun that we are protected from, not only the sun, this another aspect from the whole universe, the whole solar system that we're protected from, is basically the idea of meteorites that are always going to hit us. And that's what you think of when you're being protected. There's so many meteorites in the outside of Earth, and they're just surrounding, they're ready to hit us. And I believe the figure is a couple thousand meteorites hit Earth a day. But the thing is, they're huge when they're outside of Earth. Once they reach the atmosphere, they immediately start to burn up because of the atmosphere's protective properties. It starts to burn up, and eventually by the time it passes the atmosphere and reaches the Earth, most of it lands in the ocean, thankfully. But the atmosphere, by the time it passes the atmosphere, it actually burns most of it and is in a much smaller form than what it was before it came here. And we don't have an issue of meteorite drills. We have other issues to deal with, but meteorites are not one of the things, because we are protected from the sky. We have issues within here. Storms are something within the sky, but everything else from this outside, we are generally protected from. And that is all about astronomy from the Quran. Maybe there's more, but that will take another couple hundred years to prove by science. But when it's proved by science, maybe I'll be back. Hopefully they also discover something to make our lives longer, inshallah. But over time, as time passes, they're going to figure out many more things. They're going to prove many more facts that this Quran actually produced. Some things that we didn't realize the Quran actually predicted. Much later, they'll be like, oh, I thought it was just, you know, a metaphor. I thought it just meant something else that was actually turned out to be true. And that's that is astronomy. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.